incidents of sexual violence or bride burning, gruesome attacks on women, and we've become so immune to it. And then there are critics, analyzers, who say, why analyzing trends, why did this happen, how do we stop it, what next should we do? And in the process also we analyze victims, and we have certain transfixed notions about victims. That a victim of sexual violence will act like this, her demeanor will be like this, her actions will be like this, or she will look like a victim. Similarly, for victims of domestic violence, we have certain fixed notions of how a victim of domestic violence looks, her situation, her life, from where she's coming from, her husband must be an alcoholic, she must be a poverty-stricken woman living in the slums. Now, these notions are so fixed in our memory that when a victim doesn't fall into this category, we doubt her credibility. We doubt, was she really a victim? Is the story credible? Is she making this all up? So all these questions come into our mind. Because for us, a real victim has to be fit into a particular frame. So let me here start with my own story. I'm a victim of domestic violence. And I was in a very violent marriage for 13 long years. In 1984, when I wrote my personal story, many people did not believe it. And they said, she doesn't look like a victim. She looks confident, she can speak English. How can she be a victim of domestic violence? But in my book, I have described the very nuanced ways in which domestic violence happens and how helpless the victim gets and the despair you get into. You begin to doubt your own self. And when I talk about domestic violence, in my case, I'm not talking about a slap here or a hateful comment somewhere. I'm talking about broken nose, blood everywhere, broken bones, hit on the eyes, black bruises all over. I'm talking about real beating. And you never expect this when you get married. You don't bargain for this. Like a young, starry-eyed girl at 20, you get married, you believe in your parents, you believe in the society, and say, okay, now I'm going to get a life which is very happy, happily ever after notions. And there I was in this broken marriage and looking around for help, family, church, society, neighbors, and everybody tells you, hey, adjust. You be in that situation. Or there's something you must be doing wrong because of which you attract violence. So if you change, things will be okay. But things never become okay. Things continue. Intensity of the violence reduces, but not the fear of violence. So it affects your psyche. And I raised 3 children in this marriage. And my fear, my anxiety were transferred onto my children. They became nervous wrecks. And then finally I decided to leave and leave on my own and stand on my own feet and become a survivor. From the victim to become a survivor is a long journey. So in 1990, before that I have to say something else. That time I was not even educated. It's not that I just walked into something and became a lawyer. It is again a long journey. I was just SSC level educated in Kannada medium, not even from Bombay. So I had to get my graduation done while looking after 3 children. Then I got my law degree, then post-graduation in law, MPhil in law, writing law books, which are now some of them are textbooks for students in law colleges. That's been my journey. Sounds very spectacular. You won't recognize the victim that was there then. But of course, I still have neighbors who say, oh my God, now you look so confident. You look so beautiful now. Because when you're a nervous wreck, your entire personality gets affected. So in 1990, we started this organization called Majlis. And one of the main aims of this organization is to work with victims of domestic violence and sexual violence. and help them to walk the legal journey. We have constantly two narratives before us. Whenever an incident of violence happens, we ask for more stringent laws, with the notion that stringent laws will be deterrent and the crime will stop. Year after year, we have gone on saying the same thing. We want death penalty, we want life imprisonment for the entire life of the accused, under 12, everybody should be hanged, etc. This is one narrative. The second narrative that goes on the flip side, women misuse law. Domestic violence law is misused, 498 is misused, POCSO, the Child Abuse Act, is misused. Constantly we hear women and girls misusing the law. We never hear of men misusing the law. We never hear about it. All the laws that men have, men abuse, they never misuse. But they are law abiding. Women are these crafty, manipulative things, always putting men into trouble. So while we are asking for more laws, we don't expect women to use those laws. Because if they use, it will be a misuse. And we have a third narrative that says, courts don't work. Police don't work. Don't go to any of these places because these places are not meant for women. So if you are a victim of domestic violence, there are laws there, but you shouldn't be using them at all. You shouldn't be going to the police because police will not help you. A police station is not a place for you. So caught between these different narratives, how do you help a woman? So that's why Madhuri started to bridge the gap between these narratives and make the laws accessible to the victims who actually need it. And having gone to my own experience of a legal case, going to court, I know exactly what it is from the level of victim to become a survivor through the legal journey. And what are the obstacles there? The lawyers, the prosecutors, the judges, the entire environment is so hostile to women. So we today have a team of around 20, 25 people, all women organization, lawyers and non-lawyers, helping providing socio-legal support to victims of sexual violence, helping them to become survivors. To victims of domestic violence, helping them to be survivors. So what exactly do we do? Let's take the case of a young girl who's raped. Maybe raped by a neighbor. Maybe under the promise of marriage. Now, a FIR is filed in the police station. And the child is left loose there. And finally, she has to appear in court and give her verdict. Maybe after a year or 2 years. What happens in the meantime for this victim? She's dropped out of the school. Maybe the family had to move out. If it is a father who's the breadwinner, he's incarcerated. Family is into poverty. There are lots of pressures operating from the lawyer for the accused. Everybody telling them, adjust, settle. Do not prosecute. You'll be in trouble if you do. You'll be stigmatized. And all the pressures go on. So in the midst of it, how do we explain the legal procedure to this little girl and her mother? How the medical examination has to be done? What is the panchanama? What is the recording of the victim's statement? How many visits to the police station? How many visits to the courtrooms? How many visits everywhere? And their accused is out on bail. He's back in the same neighborhood. In one of our cases, very recently, there was a rape case and a small child was raped. Because they filed the case, there was a pressure to retract. And the accused family came with a knife and slashed the mother in her throat on her ribs. This is what the family has to go through. This is what the family has to endure. And then the final test comes when she gives evidence in court. For a child who has never gone to school, can you imagine what the school is like, what the court is like? I'm sure if any of you have to give evidence in court, you will tremble, you will shiver, you will not be able to face cross-examination. And now we expect this little child to be cross-examined by an astute criminal lawyer. And she has to narrate the incident exactly as it happened, as the police have recorded it in their own language, which she may not have even read. But everything must fall in place very meticulously, without any help, without any aid, nobody guiding her. And that's where we come in. We do a mock trial. We help her to understand what is the prosecuting lawyer, what is the defense lawyer, what is the role of a judge, and what questions will be asked, and how she must reply. And if she's uncomfortable, she can ask the judge to clarify. If she wants water to drink, she can ask the judge for a water to drink. If she wants a break, she can ask. All these are in law. But nobody uses this. A victim doesn't understand. Prosecutor doesn't care. Judge is indifferent. Judge sits there in a high pedestal. So how do we make it actually happen? You have a law in place. We have many laws in place. How do we actually make them happen so that this child is able to give evidence in court which is reliable, which can help the prosecution in getting a conviction? Because if she doesn't, she'll be termed a liar. Every woman, every child you ask, what do you want? I want justice. What is the justice? How do we spell out this justice notion? And for some, it is conviction. For others, it is many other things. But to be termed a liar because medical examination was not done properly, because a police investigation was done not done properly, because DNA test of a pregnant child does not match with the accused, because he's not the only one who abused her. There might have been many others. Child is only 12. Child is only 13. She didn't even know she was pregnant. Just accidentally these things come out. So the danger here is that if she is not able to get a conviction, there is stigma attached on her for life, and she has to live with it. So our efforts are to get a maximum conviction so that she is not termed a liar in the society. Generally, in society, in Maharashtra, a conviction rate is about 20%. In the cases that we work, a conviction rate is between 60 to 70%. And that's how it is. That's how what difference a support person can actually make. For domestic violence, we have reached up to around 50,000 women and helped them to change their lives. Not just get through a court case, but through all other support skills. Getting back to education, getting a job, getting a house, getting maintenance in court, giving admission, helping to get admission for their children, relocating themselves. It's a whole lot of things. And that's what we try to do. And our aim ultimately is to change victims into survivors. Victims do not become survivors by just changing the terminology of calling a victim a survivor. It is a long journey through which the victim interacts with the legal processes. And in the process, in this course, she changes the legal process itself. Because every time they have not followed up a case, they have not followed up the rules in a particular case, we bring it to the higher authorities, to the police, to the judges, to see that in this particular instance, this particular law was not followed. This particular rule was not followed. And through that, try to change the system so that eventually the system itself becomes more sensitive to victims of domestic and sexual violence. Thank you very much.